You know, many times you can be so familiar with something that you don't take care of it. You can be so familiar coming to church. You can be so familiar with your car. You don't even need to check anything. Is that also? Just go and drive. But you know, familiarity can lead you not to take things seriously. And that's one thing we need to know. God has given us the most excellent thing, name on the earth, in heaven and under the earth. Jesus gave us the power of attorney, the legal rights to use his name. All power and all authority that Jesus had is invested in his name, in the name of Jesus. Do we have the power of attorney to use his name? You know, many times when we pray, some people pray, "Oh Lord, for Jesus' sake," we pray. Which sake of Jesus? Have you heard people pray that prayer? They say, "I pray in Jesus' sake." You don't pray for his sake. You pray in his name. And the word of God teaches us that we do. Jesus said that we could use his name in prayer. He said that we could use his name in dealing with demons. He said that we could use his name in ministry, healing. In fact, the secret is in the using the name of Jesus. Many times, we worry about issues of life without making use of that name. And the greatest name, the excellent name, the most powerful name that God has given to you is not the president of America. No! If you go to somewhere and say, "I'm coming to you in the name of the president of America," we just look at you, man. The demons will laugh at you and say, "We don't know him." I'm serious. But when you go there in the name of Jesus, something else will happen. And that's why Jesus said something. He said in John chapter 16, let's go to it again. You know, at times we read the word of God, but if you don't apply the word of God to what you're supposed to do, it may never bring the result that we desire. John chapter 16, and I want us to look at it carefully. John chapter 16. And I want us to read verse 23 and 24. We read it again. It said, "In that day you shall ask me what? Nothing. Verily, verily," that word "verily" means truly, truly, "I say to you, whatsoever you shall ask the Father in my name, he will give it you." In other words, if you ask God anything in the name of who? Jesus. God will do what? God will give it to you. You know what he's talking about? It means if you ask God for anything he has not created, God will create it for you because you ask in the name of who? Jesus. If there's anything that God has not made and you are asking him, God will create it. Brethren, we can't overemphasize that. And look at verse 24. He said, "Here before you have asked nothing in my name. Ask and you shall what? Receive. That your joy may be what?" If you want your joy to be full, you must ask. God is telling us, "Look, you have not bothered." Some people think they are bothering God too much by demanding too much from him. All the resources that God has in heaven, what is he going to do with it? Except to bless you, his children, and to bless the church. But you find that many times we don't take advantage of what God has given to us. We take it lightly. And also when you look at the passage you read in Hebrews, it makes us to know that we need to take seriously the name of Jesus. That name is the most powerful name on the earth and on the heaven and underneath the earth. In Hebrews, the Bible makes us to know that passage that our brother read to us. In Hebrews chapter 1, it makes us to know that God himself has given us a name. He said, "For you," you know, let me read. He said, "God has sundry times and in diverse manner spoke in time past to our father by the prophets, but as in these last days, spoken to us by his Son, Jesus Christ,
whom he has appointed heirs of all things, by whom also he made the world. Whether you believe it or not, the world was made by Jesus. The Bible said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was what? What God. The thing that God spoke out was Jesus, and he created everything. Who being in the brightness of his glory and the express of his person and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he has by himself purged our sins and sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high, being made so much better than angels. And he has by inheritance obtained what? A more excellent name than they all. When you pray, don't pray in the name of angels. If you pray in the name of angels, God will never answer your prayer. If you pray in the name of any other name, God will never answer. I'm telling you, whether you believe it or not, this is the true cross of the matter. Many people find it difficult to accept. And there are reasons. God says, whatever you ask in his name, he gave him, he obtained a more excellent name. And he said, to which of the angels has he at any time said, you are my son, and this day have I begotten you? And again, I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. And again, when he brings him in the beginning, because in the world, he says, and let all the angels of the Lord do what? Worship him. Hallelujah.
Amen.
All the angels of God, they worship whom? Jesus. To worship Jesus. That's why we need to worship him. Many people don't want to. We have depended too much of the time on our own ability. You depend so much on your ability, what you can do to deliver you. Whereas God wants you to rely upon that name, Jesus. And we're going to see from the scriptures. I'm wondering why is God reminding me and saying, talk about the name of Jesus, the most excellent name. Brethren, that name should be in your mouth. You know, if anything is happening, you know, some of the people, what they will remember, they say, my goodness. Your goodness will not save you. It is the name of Jesus. If anything is happening, that name Jesus should be in your mouth. When you are sleeping, it should be in your mind, in your spirit, in your every part of you. That name Jesus. Anything that is happening around you, let that name be inside of you. I'm telling you, that name Jesus is the most powerful name in heaven, on earth, and underneath the earth. Three levels. The uses of the name of Jesus. Let's look at the uses. The first thing that we can use that name of is in prayer. And as I mentioned, John 16:24, he said, hitherto means up to now, up to this time, you have not asked anything in my name, in the name of Jesus. We pray the Father, we pray to God, and Jesus take our needs to him to carry out his will. He take our place before the Father in prayers. The name of Jesus. Let me tell you one thing. If you mention that name, Jesus, heaven and earth shivers. They're shaking. I'm telling you the truth. The demon shakes. Circumstances and situations, they bow down. That name, Jesus. Sickness, bow down. Afflictions, bow down. The door that are locked, open, because the name of Jesus. Hear it and they shake. The name Jesus. But we have not been using it as we're supposed to be. We use it sparingly. We use it, let me not overuse it. You cannot overuse it, neither can you overdraw that name, Jesus. Witches, wizards, bow down at the name of Jesus. Sickness, bow down at the name of Jesus. Circumstances that are difficult, bow down at the name of Jesus. In prayer. It's not only in prayer. Jesus himself said, everything you use my name for is going to back it up. Jesus backs it up because he has the power. Let's look at John chapter 14. John chapter 14 verse 13 says, I'm important for you to tap into that name. Make use of it every second of your life. It's a blank check that God has given to you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But many times, we use it and just get tired of it and say, well, and some of us even use it without even having trust and faith in it. The second thing which you can use the name of Jesus for, apart from prayer, is that we use that name in combat. Say in combat. Combat means warfare. Warfare. The Bible says we are not fighting against what? Flesh and what? And blood. But against what? Principalities and what? And powers. And spiritual what? Wickedness. In high places. There are wickedness. I think our brother mentioned about wickedness in high places. Some people are so wicked that they don't want you to go ahead. The devil doesn't like you to succeed. He wants to put you in bondage. He wants to put you in affliction. He wants to oppress your life. He wants to depress you. He doesn't want you to enjoy the full blessing of God. He goes around troubling people's lives. Let me share something with you that happened this past week. I was at work, and I was talking to one of our foremen, and I said, "How are you doing? And how's your wife?" He said, "Let me show you a photo for my cell phone." He said, "Foreman," and he put on his phone. You know what he showed me? He said, "I saw a lady that was so drunken, and she was lying in the middle of the road, 2 a.m. She said, "That was my ex-wife." I said, "What? Your ex-wife? What did she do?" He said, I knew straight away. I said, "She was drunken." Say yes. She was completely drunken. You think that is a good life? And you know her position? She was a bank manager. She was a bank manager. I don't want to mention the bank. She was a bank manager. She was doing very well. Because of drunkenness, they fired her. She lost the job. Not only that she lost the job, she lost her husband. She lost everything. Why? Because the devil held her life in what? In bondage. Bondage! Don't you think she needs deliverance? Think about it. There are people in this nation, in these our places where we work, that are entrapped by drugs, by affliction, by suicide. The Bible says the thief cometh not but to steal, to kill, and to what? And to destroy. Jesus said, "I have come that you may have what? Life. And have it abundantly." Even we Christians, the devil attacks us. Attacks your finance. Attacks your health. He doesn't want you to progress. You want you to stay put at one place. He said, "Come down." The Bible says we are not fighting against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in every place. The blessings that God has ordained for you, the devil says, "No way, you're not going to get it." That's why you need to stand up, brethren. When you're dealing with the enemy, there should be no mercy. No mercy. If somebody comes to kill you and you get hold of that person, for there's nothing bad in that, my friend. Otherwise, the person will kill you. What that name is. One day I slept and somebody came to attack me. I laughed. "Came to attack me? You're finished. You are a dead person." Because the Bible says, "Greater is he that is what? That is in me than he that is in the world." That person came, covered her face so that I won't see her face, and came to attack me. She was doing that. You know what I remember? The only thing I was just calling was what? The name what? Jesus. As I shouted, "Jesus!" She started squeezing and wavering. I said, "In Jesus' name!" Until she disappeared. Brethren, if you don't have the name of Jesus inside you, the name of Jesus is not working inside your life, you're missing something out. And that's why God has sent me. Open your Bible with me to Mark chapter 16. Mark chapter 16, because God has given us a blank check. A blank check so that we can use it. Mark chapter 16, verse 17 to 18. If God himself has given us things we need to use for our life, we need to make use of it. If we don't make use of it, we are missing something out. The most excellent name. We need to make use of that excellent name. Mark chapter 16, verse 17. Listen to this.
And these signs will follow those who believe. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will take up serpents, and if they drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay hands on the sick, and they will recover.
Jesus came. This is the last word of Jesus before he left the world. He said, these signs shall follow them that do not believe.
That believe.
Eh?
That believe.
These signs will follow them that do what?
That believe.
Those who have faith in him. Those who believe in Jesus, who have accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior. He didn't say these signs shall follow the pastors. He didn't say these signs shall follow the ministers. He said these signs shall follow them that believe. Say, I believe.
I believe.
This sign must follow me.
This sign must follow me.
If you believe, this sign is for you. In my name, they will cast out what? Demons. They will cast out demons. He said, in my name, they shall speak with what? New tongues. Speak, I believe in speaking in tongues. The Bible says, he that speaketh in tongues speaketh mysteries to God. They shall take up serpent, and if they drink any deadly thing, shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall what?
Recover.
The Bible didn't say if you lay hands on the sick, they won't recover. So where did you get the idea that if you lay hands on the sick, they won't recover? It didn't say pastors, it didn't say ministers, believers. Believers! This is what God wants us to do. Let me tell you one thing. Jesus has given us this name to be used in combat against unseen forces that surround us. Whether you believe it or not, there are unseen forces that surround us that want to. Does he want you to progress? Want you to be merry-go-round, run the same thing? The blessing that God has given to you, they don't want you to get it. They make you to labor and labor in vain. They want you to be lamenting and to be sad with life and to be crying. Wipe all your tears and take authority and sign the blank check that God has given to us and make use of it. That name Jesus. Brethren, when God laid this body, I said, but we've been talking about the name of Jesus. God said, now go and talk about it again. And I said, that name Jesus. Brethren, something great will happen before the end of this year. Amen.
Amen.
Because God wants to wake us up from our slumber so that we can make use of the name that God has given to us.
Yes.
That name Jesus.
Yes.
It's a blank check that God has given to us. Many people are dying.
That's it.
One man was just sharing with me last week when we finished the service. And I was driving. The Spirit of God said, branch here. I said, to branch what? He said, go and see so, so and so. And I branched him. As I branched him, I met the man, frankly speaking. I was shocked. I said, God. And the man started talking to me about his son. When he finished, I was so sad. And I have to pray. And I said, this man, the son needs what? Deliverance. I started praying for the son that God will set that boy free from every affliction of the enemy. The devil tried to destroy his life. You know how many people life are being destroyed and they are wallowing in prison and in jail? Yeah. They are wallowing in prison and they are in jail. Brethren, Matthew chapter 28. Open your Bible with me to Matthew chapter. I know you know this thing. Like we read in the Sunday school. I know that you know these things, but there's nothing wrong for me to do what? To remind you again. That's what we read in Sunday school. Matthew 28. I know our time is fast spent, but let's look at it. Matthew chapter 28, verse 18 to 20. Let somebody read it for us. And somebody will read Matthew 18, 19, and 22. We will read it and let's hear what God has to say. Yes, Matthew 28. Anybody that is there?
And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying,
mm-hmm.
All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age.
In other words, God gave us this great commission. Jesus gave us this great commission. He said something. All power is given to me where? In heaven and on what?
Authority.
It means that authority is in the name of who? Jesus.
Jesus.
Is that name? Throughout this week, starting from this moment, start to implement that name, Jesus, and see what he will do for you. All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, do what? Go in my name. Go and make disciples. Go and minister to people. Go and set free. Start with yourself. Today, by the time we finish, yoke will be broken.
Amen.
Every blockage that the enemy has blocked, God will open it in the name of Jesus. I remember a man. I think I've shared this before. This man passed. He took an exam and he passed the exam. He got 500 and something, 580 or something like that. And he did very well. They were supposed to give him admission because of his performance. But they never gave him. They gave people who are 400 and something. If somebody got 500 and something, is it not the one that's supposed to be considered first before somebody they give that got 400? He didn't get it. And everybody was wondering, why? Because there are forces of darkness behind it. And so the Lord gave this man, this young man gave him a revelation. He said, I saw three stones. Everywhere I want to pass, these stones are just blocking me. I want to pass here, they block it. I want to pass here, they block it. I want to pass here, they block it. See, I can pass. But there is a way there, but they put stones there. All those are stones of wickedness to make you to do what? To suffer. Of course, by the name of Jesus, prayer was prayed, that stone rolled away. Your stone that is blocking your way, God will roll it away today in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
The thing that want to delay the blessing of God upon your life, go forth. Let us not live as somebody who has no God. That our life is so miserable. Matthew chapter 18. Let's go to Matthew chapter 18. Because God has given us things in his word. Matthew chapter 18. I can't finish this message today, but we'll finish it next week by the grace of God. Matthew chapter 18, verse 19 and 20. Let's start from verse 18. Somebody read for us. Matthew 18, 18 to 20, please.
Verily I say unto you.
Yes.
Whatsoever you shall bind. Shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever you shall close on earth shall be closed in heaven. Again, I say unto you that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done by them of my Father which is in heaven.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Verse 20.
For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am.
Listen to this. Jesus said, these are the words of Jesus Christ. I didn't say it. He said, I say, verily I say unto you, truly. Jesus said, I'm not deceiving you. I'm telling you the truth. I say unto you, whatsoever you shall bind on earth shall be bound what? In heaven. Whatever you bind, I said, this thing is bound. It will be bound in heaven.
Amen.
It is the authority that God has given to us as a church.
Yes.
But many times, we don't make use of it. And he said, whatever you lose on earth shall be lost in what?
In heaven.
Today you will lose all your blessing. Amen.
Amen.
Wherever they are, let my blessing flow to me on him that.
Yes.
The places, the things you want me to reach, Lord, I receive it today in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
The Bible says, whatever you lose, you need to lose your finance. You need to use your health. You need to lose your work. And say, Lord, let it be losing to me. They will be searching for you. And say, where is that guy? Because God is able to do it. Hallelujah. It is God who said it. Jesus who said it. He said, I say to you, two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything. Anything is anything. They shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. You know, some people, when they ask them to pray in the church, in their heart, they never agree with it. Let us pray, oh, well, you say amen, but in their heart, they don't agree. How do you expect something to happen? How do you expect if there's no agreement in deep inside your heart? Everybody should resolve. If you don't agree, raise it and say, I don't agree with this issue. Resolve that thing first. Then you pray on it. Concerning anything here on that. Look at that. Jesus didn't say -2, -2, or too difficult. Is anything too difficult for God?
Nope.
But many times we behave as if God cannot do it. God has made the wall of Jericho to fall down flat. God has made the way for the children of Israel to go on a dry land. That same God has not changed. And verse 20 says, where two or three are gathered together in whose name? In my name. Let me tell you, whether you believe it or not, Jesus is here.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
We may not see him physically. God open your eyes of his spiritual eye, you will see Jesus here. Because where two or three are gathered, if you are more than two there, you are there. Jesus is already there. He said, I am in the midst of what?
It's not
cajoling. Jesus is there. Why do we behave as if Jesus is not there? Once you're more than two, Jesus is already there. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Christians, please, let's wake up. God has written to all a ticket, our own check, so that we can stand up. You know, some people will sign it as small check. When somebody writes a sign check for you and print it blank, some people will say, okay, let me just not drain everyone resource with $20. Some people will put 50. But that's not the way God wants us to be. It depends on what you want to sign with it, what you want to put inside. God has given us a blank check. You sign it and put the flat thing inside. He said, if you ask anything that has not been created, God says he will do what? He will create it for you. Why should we be depressed? No! God doesn't want us to be depressed. God doesn't want us to be knocked down. God wants you to rise up and walk because he has given us his name to use. You will pray that that name will sink inside your spirit man. Because if that name doesn't make with faith inside of you, it's useless. How did Jesus get the excellent name? The Bible says he obtained, I'm going to mention three methods, three ways Jesus got that name. That name isn't just for him. It came to him, number one, by inheritance. The Bible says he inherited that name. If you look in Hebrews, he said Jesus inherited it. Amen?
Amen.
A more excellent name than they all. He inherited it. You know what they call inheritance? Your parents go and they leave inheritance for you. You inherit because they gave it to you by inheritance. Hebrews make us to know that he inherited. We read that Hebrews in Acts chapter 13. The Bible makes us to know also how he got it. Acts chapter 13, verse 33. And I will read that quickly, please. Acts 13, 33, because I want to be rounding up. Acts 13, verse 33. Hear the word of the Lord. In verse 33, he says, God has fulfilled the same to us, their children, in that he has raised up Jesus again, as is also written in the second Psalm. You are my son. This day have I what? Begotten you. God begotten you. He got it by begotten. He was inherited. In Hebrews chapter 2, verse 9, you see the same thing there. God gave him a name which is above every name. In Hebrews chapter 2, verse 9. And I read it. He said, but we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, and that he, by grace of God, should taste death for who? Every man. Jesus tasted death for me, so that we not perish. So anybody that doesn't believe Jesus Christ, they are due because he tasted death. He paid the price for them. But if you don't believe Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are due. There's something you're losing. Every other passage you will see in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, Acts chapter 2, 25 to 27, 29 to 31, you see, by inheritance, Jesus got that name. No other person did that for you. Number two, Jesus got this by bestowal. He was bestowed upon Jesus. You know, when you sit for an exam and you pass, and they write there, by the virtue of the authority conferred upon me by the institution, we confer upon you, Joshua. You are now MP. Hallelujah. It's bestowed because of the virtue. They conferred it. It was bestowed upon Jesus. Let's look at the three levels. In Philippians chapter 2. Let's look at it. Philippians chapter 2. I know you know this passage. Philippians chapter 2, starting from verse 9 to 11. Let somebody read it if you're there.
Wherefore God has highly exalted him.
Yes.
And giving him a name which is above every name.
Mm-hmm.
That at the name of Jesus every knee should bow.
Yes.
Of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth.
Hmm. Verse 11.
And that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father.
Listen to this. Verse 9 says, wherefore God has what? Highly what?
Exalted
him. Who exalted Jesus?
God.
And that's why when you look at the book of Revelation, the Bible says, when Jesus entered heaven with his blood, if you don't believe in Jesus, this thing, you're not partaker of this blessing.
Mm.
Jesus entered heaven with his blood. The Bible says there was silence in heaven for how many minutes? 30 minutes. In heaven, there's never been a time they stop singing. But when Jesus entered the place, all singing, all worship stopped for 30 minutes. Because they are seeing things they have never won. Jesus now presented and said, Lord, I died for these people. Anyone that will believe in me, let his or her sin be what?
Forgiven.
Anyone that will believe in me and he prays in my name, Lord, let his or her prayer be what? Answered. Anyone that is in trouble and we call upon you, O God, by my name, let that person be delivered.
Yes.
Anyone that is destined to die and call upon you and mention my name, let the sentence of death be canceled. God, say that. And God said today, I sanction it. And God took the rubber stamp of heaven and stamped it. And then it is done forever. The Bible says three levels. He said, and the name of Jesus, every knee shall what?
Bow.
Higher in heaven, on earth. When in heaven you mention that name, every knee bows. On earth, they bow. And not only that.